Our next installment of Meet the Squad, which are a slate of California candidates running for the state legislature that Working Families Parties has endorsed. As you know, if you've been following us, WFP considers the state legislature one of the most important bodies, elected bodies in the country. They represent one out of every eight Americans and is one of the most prolific legislative bodies in the country. In fact, on most issues that we care about, ranging from sentencing reform to funding for public schools to climate change and wealth tax, many of these issues are being fought at the state level and not at the federal level. And we're trying to bring a more laser focus to our state legislatures and the candidates that we really believe will represent our communities here in California and put working families first. I'm really excited to have on here someone we would call an original squad member before the squad even existed, Alex Lee, who is the youngest member of the California State Legislature and only one of two members that has committed to be corporate free, along with Assemblymember Ash Kara, who represents his neighboring district. Alex has been a true champion for working families, introducing and leading on bills like the wealth tax, social housing, reforming Ellis Act so we can strengthen protections for our most vulnerable renters, and much, much more. So really excited to have Assemblymember Lee on. Assemblymember, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me and calling me the original squad before the squad. That's really cool.
So many of our supporters and audience members already know you, but share a little bit more about who you are and why you decide to run for Assembly at such a young age.
Yeah, so it all comes down to literally where I'm sitting right now. This room where I'm sitting in is the room that I grew up in. I went to high school here. I came back from college every weekend to come back here. And that is the reality, is because even though people make fun of me for it, some conservative people, is that I live at home. And that's the only way I can represent the district that I grew up in and that I have to live in. In the Bay Area, especially in the South Bay, it is way too expensive to live in the community you grew up in that you made successful. And that's because of a lot of different ways, because, you know, there are folks who have kept the status quo and kept folks out. And there are also commodifiers that have kept prices up. And those are the forces that I was really motivated to work on. And at the same time, I had worked prior to being a state assemblyman myself, I had worked for the state legislature in the Senate and the Assembly. And I saw up and close how frustrating it is that we have Democratic supermajorities, we have a Democratic all executives and governors, and yet we don't do the things that by and large Californians want. And it was really frustrating. So when I started running at 23, I was like, if not me, then who? And it was a long shot race. We all thought we're gonna lose up until the day the election happened. And me and my whole team, we were so surprised that we actually won. But in hindsight, it shouldn't be surprising, because we knocked on 30,000 doors, went to every small event, and we were always very clear about what we wanted to do. And with the same experience of legislative experience and this clear agenda, I got there on day one and I did everything I said, including trying to ban corporate money from politics. And I hope that, you know, that's what my voters and my constituents value the most.
Your race was incredibly exciting to watch in the winter, spring of 2020. And so exciting that you won that race. But as you know, not a lot of young people historically have run for the state legislature, although we have a number of 20-something candidates this year, a number of whom are part of our squad that we're hoping to elect this November 8th. Why the state legislature? Many people talk about Congress or the mayor's office or city council. Why did you want to run for the state legislature, and what made the California legislature sexy to you?
Yeah, well, I think California state legislature is sexy in the way that you have a really great partner, a partner that provides for you without you even thinking about them or asking for it. That's the way it is. You know, Congress gets, and the president, of course, they get all this attention, but the things that people every day care about, the condition of your roads, the fairness of your justice system or schools, and if they're tuition free or not, or even having healthcare, that's all done at the state level. I always tell my constituents, the state legislature and the state government can do everything Congress can do except for three things. We cannot deport people, we cannot declare war, and we cannot print our own money. Those just are the only three things we can't do, but everything else we can do. And so everything you care about, we can do. And I think in some ways, and I try, that's in my ways of also trying to recruit some of the squad members too, is like to try to appeal to them, is in some ways it's good for progressive and even young folks or folks of any age really to go run for legislature, because anything that you care about, we can do. Unlike, and this is me speaking without having been a local elected, but unlike city councils or school boards, I truly believe those duties are a bit more narrow, as they should be, right? They're a bit more narrow, they're more focused, and those are different jobs altogether. But if you are about solving climate change in a big picture sense, or you want to reform the criminal justice system, a school board probably isn't the best position for that, or a county supervisor might not always be the best for that. But at the legislature, we really reshape the entire state, and a state as big as ours, it has the whole nation following us. So it's really important.
So as someone who has been watching the state legislature from a young age, has worked for the state legislature before you ran for office, what do you think would have been different if we had been able to elect the squad that we're endorsing today 5 years ago?
If we had a squad, even 5 years ago, then obviously I'd probably be working for them. Honestly, I wouldn't have to be the one running myself. No, but it's so incredible. I mean, even though the squad and the folks that WFP has endorsed does not constitute a majority of even the Democratic caucus, I think we cannot underestimate how important it is to have a small group, even but more intensely committed to our values. We may not always have a numerical advantage, but we have the commitment or the passion, and we also have the organizing power. Just say, for example, like when I took this seat, you know, we actually were able to do a lot of things. We weren't able to pass every single thing as quickly as we want, but one member can introduce anything they want, and they can organize, and they can change the narrative in that sense. Now imagine if you had 20 of those people who are all committed to the same narrative, then we really are going to be pushing it. Even if we don't represent entire 41 votes to pass everything, I think we have enough power to do that. And I think it's incredible if we had our own squad to just leverage that power.
It's been really incredible to watch you, Alex, just even over the last year and a half, and the amplification of issues that you have brought to the public on what the state legislature can do just by introducing bills that demonstrate these are the things that we could have been doing or should be doing, but aren't doing. And I think that you're a big reason as to why we have at least four other candidates in their 20s running for the state legislature, which is truly incredible. I don't think we've ever seen this many young people run for the state legislature. And as you know, we have 26-year-old mayor of Delano City, Brian Osorio, 26-year-old policy organizer in Orange, Bomar Vicente, 28-year-old Kudahi mayor, Elizabeth Alcantar, and someone who might become the youngest member of state legislature, 23-year-old South San Francisco City Council member, James Coleman. Nice. And so I really believe that you have been a key part of helping to make the state legislature sexier for our young activists and young leaders. And talking about what you've been able to accomplish just from an optics perspective, what have you been the most proud of accomplishing on the state legislature over your time?
Yeah, I think actually humbly in a way, I'm very proud of that fact that I've helped pave the way for more progressive and more young people to take that leap. And I think the incredible thing is, you know, as evidenced by WFP's endorsements, these are also very viable people. All the people running that you've listed are much better well-positioned than I was when I ran. You know, they're elected officials in their own right. They have a lot of, you know, great endorsements, great fundraising, all these great ground game. When we did it, it was like, you know, us working at a garage, kind of like classic Silicon Valley startup almost kind of story. Like we had much, much less resources. And I'm very proud that I think we've opened the minds for a lot of people to do these things and take these risks. I'm very proud of that. But at the same time, I'm also very proud of a lot of the bills we've been able to get attention to, like when it becomes like the wealth tax or working on universal single payer healthcare and getting it so close to the finish line of the assembly. But I'm especially proud of our social housing bill, which it was just an idea when I came into legislature. I was like, I want to do like social housing. There's a lot of smart people out there. And I was just a freshman member, but I was like, maybe someone else will do it, but I guess not. Like I just had an idea and I wrote a 20-page bill, like personally a lot of my own investment. And we wrote a really great bill that has environmentalists, housing activists, labor leaders, all coming together to support a really big effort. And now it's on its way to the floor. I think I'm really proud to get social housing this far.
there's a ton of excitement about your social housing bill. And there aren't very many bills that I hear so much chatter around in my political circles as your social housing bill. So congratulations on that. I actually, just totally out of curiosity, who is the next youngest member of the state legislature after you?
Right now it is Isaac Bryan, who's 30 years old. So when he came in, he was 29, but he left me when he turned 30 in his birthday a couple months ago. So I'm holding it down for the 20s right now.
Well, we hope we're able to add at least four more to that generation on the state legislature. So this is now your second time running for office. So you know how physically and emotionally grueling this process is and can be. And I know there must be days that you wake up and you ask yourself why you're doing this. But as someone who's run in six election cycles, something that I've always found really invigorating is, you know, the canvassing and door knocking that you do when you get to meet the real folks that you're representing. And I thought it would be fun if you were able to share one of your favorite door knocking or canvassing stories with our audience members over your two election cycles.
Yeah, that definitely is the reason that keeps me going. I think the worst part of this job is the politics, right? There's a lot of pettiness, divisiveness, but when it comes down to it, the thing that brings me back to it is being able to realize the aspirations of my district, of my voters, and of my constituents. And I really remember this a lot. I remember this story very vividly. I was door knocking in August 2019. So it was more than half a year away from the election still. It was like 100 degrees. And I was knocking in Newark, which is one of the smaller towns in my district. And I was like sweating and everything. And I came out and talked to this guy, and he gave me water too at the door. But he's like, I forgot exactly how this conversation went. It was really positive, but he was like, you know, and that's why I'm going to vote for you. He's like, because I want you to be a respectful pain in the ass up there. I want you to be fighting for us because that's your job, right? Like, it's not to go schmooze with everyone and get along all the time. It's to fight for us. And that's why I'm going to do it. And I remember I was very, very sweaty, but I remember that phrase just being a respectful pain in the ass. And I actually said that to legislators the first day I got there. I was like, that's my job. And that's what I'm going to do. And I think I've lived up to it.
That is an awesome story. Something also that many folks don't realize about the state legislature is the sacrifice that our representatives make to serve in Sacramento. So tell folks what it's like to commute to Sacramento and what is your commute like during the week?
Yeah, I'm fortunate that I am closer to Sacramento. I don't have to fly or drive like 18 hours or something. But my commute is either I take the train, the Amtrak from Fremont, and that's like 3 hours one way, or I drive depending on the schedule, and it's about 2 hours. And it's every week. So Monday, Thursday, I'm in Sacramento. Friday, Sunday, I'm back in the Bay Area. And no, I don't take any days off. It's just constantly working different things. And I think it's just part of the job, like, you know, to constantly be there and available for folks, especially because we're in the midst of many crises right now. I think I have to be there for folks. So we're always around. And the other little known fact is, and this, hopefully this will not be a surprise to some of our other squad members running, but you don't get a pension or anything. You're legally disallowed from it. And the pay is decent depending where you are from, where your home residence is. And that's actually part of the state constitution. Like, governors, judges, they get paid a heck of a lot more money and they get a state pension. And that's hard and limiting for working class people. It's very hard, right? So that's why you also see a lot of candidates come in who are independently wealthy, who already have their retirement settled. You know, I think for us right now, we are thinking about the community, but it is long-term, I think, detrimental for younger folks. So this is the prime age where you can save for retirement if there is retirement. But I think that's what puts us ahead, is like, we're really putting on the line right now. And we're probably some ways not going to be personally financially really great, and we don't have a lot of, and traditionally, I think in squads, you don't have a lot of like outside investments to like lean on. So it's hard. You work a lot, you don't get paid too much. But I think it's part of the sacrifice right now.
Something I will say about our squad is that the vast majority are working class and middle class, and no one has this pocket of extra funding that they can rely on. And so it really is a huge commitment to go to Sacramento to serve. This was actually something I believe that was taken away by voters in the 1990s, because state legislatures used to have pensions. And I really hope that we talk about reconsidering this and educating voters on why it's important to really pay our legislators well because if we don't, we're going to lose so many working and middle class voices in the state legislature that are necessary to pass policies that represent all Californians.
Yeah.
Thanks for sharing a few things that people may not know about the state legislature. Tell us something that people may not know about your district.
About my district. Yes. My district in the 24th Assembly District, the newly created one, as well as the one I currently represent, is only one of two Asian American majority districts in the entire state. Asian American majority. In the new district, by population, it's closer to 60%. And I always, you know, a lot of people for some reason will always say, well, it's whatever percent by voters. But as a representative, remember, you represent every single person that lives there, not just people who vote or don't vote. And so I always look at the population because that's important to me. So in a way, it's very, very unique. Like there is no other district like that out there. And also the second thing unique is my district has the most non-party affiliation voters in the entire state by proportion. It is like more than a third of the entire electorate. But that is because, and I always tell people, they're not all like conservatives. They're people who are done with the two-party system and are left of the Democratic Party. That's why I can be the way I am. That's why my member of Congress was the Bernie co-chair of the nation. And because we have a ton of voters who care about these things and think that we need to keep pulling the party into the Democratic Party into the modern age. And we have 15% registered Republicans, but it's like upper 30% non-NPPs or third party.
Sanders did very well in your district in 2020.
Exactly. We also had a lot of great field game out here. I knew a lot of the field organizers too, so that also helped.
We were really lucky to have an amazing field team, but also to have the resources to fund the biggest field campaign that California has seen possibly ever. And that was all powered by average donations of $17 to $19. Our top contributors were folks that worked at Starbucks and Amazon, and they funded the top fundraising Democratic candidate in the country, and that was Bernie Sanders. And so it really shows what people can do when we combine our forces together. We actually can outmaneuver, outraise, outorganize much wealthier candidates with more resources when we unite together.
Well, even on that point, Jane, so I'm one of two candidates in the entire state, one of two legislators, there's plenty of candidates now, that are corporate free, doesn't take any money from corporations directly, which federally you can't do, but, not from their PACs. And I'm still one of the more competitive legislators with money. I'm not like a top 10 or something, but I still have a very decent amount of money. And that actually shows in the same approach is being corporate free and being railroading your community does also have its own rewards. It's not easier per se, but you can still be competitive.
And I hope we're able to add to the roster of corporate free legislators in Sacramento after November 8th. So this brings us to the lightning round.
Yes.
Rapid response questions that we ask to help our listeners get to know you a little bit better. So the first question that we ask is, are you a morning or a night person?
I am a night person. I'm a night owl.
What time would you go to sleep if you could?
Well, I pretty much go to sleep at 1 a.m. every night now. But if I could, actually, ironically, I would go to sleep at like 10 p.m.
Ah, are you a coffee or a tea drinker?
Tea. I don't drink coffee at all, actually.
I also don't drink coffee. Okay. I have made it through my adult life without that type of caffeine necessary. And what kind of music do you campaign canvas to get energized?
Yeah, I get energized with like EDM music, like Odessa, Alenium, or Davin. Like those are the music I listen to.
So you told our viewers you work 7 days a week, so you may not have time to binge, but when you do have time, the slivers that you get, what would you be binging?
Yeah, I actually binge watch when I do like the more mindless campaign work, like when I'm just like writing stuff or something, like, you know, just doing something over and over again. But I really like to, I'm blanking on it now. Oh, but I really like to watch The Mandalorian. That was one of my shows I watched when I was doing campaign stuff and watching at the same time. The Mandalorian was when I like watched all of it in like 2 days.
Good answer. Baby Yoda was very popular. What are some of the favorite places you like to go and eat in your district?
Yes, my favorite place, childhood memory too, best hometown spot is a place called Pho Mai number one. That's Pho Mai, apparently. It's on the border of both the towns I grew up in, and they, I think the pandemic changed this, but they used to literally be like open till like 3 a.m. and open back at 8 a.m. So it was always perfect for us. Like, okay, we're hanging out, we're gonna go get pho. And that was the place. So great place. If you're ever in San Jose, recommend that place, especially if it's really late at night.
What is your go-to karaoke song?
Oh, I don't have one.
That's okay. Least enjoyable job you've had?
Least enjoyable job, I'll say, is in the midst of the pandemic, especially in the beginning of the pandemic, I actually did a lot of those gig app work jobs because I needed money. I was just out of the campaign mode, and I literally was doing full campaign full time. And I was going on my savings. So I was like, okay, I need money. So I did those. I won't say the app because they all suck. But I did those types where you drive around a lot and you give people stuff and you get people stuff. And it was awful because it's tempting to say, oh, this job, you'll get like $30 or $40 or something. But when you broke it down to like the time, the effort, and then like the wear and tear in your vehicle and all that stuff, it like really was like draining everything down. So you weren't even making very much. And but it was a really interesting experience, and I got to really learn more about like how awful the struggle is. And I've ever since always met people who did other app-based jobs, and they hate it as well. And actually, it was when I won my election November 2020, some of the media ran with it and talked about how I had that experience of gig work or app-based jobs, and how much I very clearly told them like I have a lived experience to tell you is awful and why it needs to be changed and why there needs to be major, major change. And yeah, the first-hand experience to see how terrible it was.
These app companies always use the argument that these are flexible jobs that provide additional cash that justify lack of job protections like paid sick days and healthcare and minimum wage compensation. And so I think it's really important to have elected officials that have experienced this work so that we're able to legislate and govern on these industries.
Absolutely.
So this is one of the hardest questions we ask our candidates. Who do you root for, the Giants or the A's?
The Giants or SF, right? I'm not a sports person. So the Giants?
All right, Giants. And if you had to delete every app but three on your phone, which three would you keep?
Am I allowed to delete my text messages? Like just stop texting?
Yeah, you can delete your text message app.
The three that I would keep is Spotify, Instagram, and I'll probably keep my messaging apps. You know, I'll keep my messaging app. So those are the three I live with. Yeah.
You know, the candidates have given wildly varying answers.
Oh, really?
On this one. And then
the funny thing about it is I used to have, this is also part of my really working class background, is that I would not upgrade my phone for like 5 years at a time or 6 years. So you get those really old models where they're like struggling, they have no more memory. So I would be like, every time people are like, oh, download the app. I'm like, I'm not going to download a new app. Like I have no space. So I would have actually I still have it today. Like I'm very app disciplined. Like I don't download new apps unless I absolutely have to. Absolutely have to.
Final question. Tell us one thing that you love about our incredible state of California.
What I love about the state of California is from its kind of inception as even a Western state is it's always been the land of possibility and big dreams. And I think today that rings true more than ever is people especially can come together and make something happen. They can change the shape of this nation and change the shape, course of history. We also remember that the progressive movement, the original progressive movement back in the 19 teens started here and was holding big corporations and corrupt politicians accountable. And we are back again 100 years later. And that's what I'm really proud of California's legacy. And I think it's built in our state DNA.
So thank you so much for joining us, Assemblymember, and to everyone that is watching till now, please come out and support and volunteer. We can only do this work if we organize, we walk, and we phone bank for our 15 endorsed WFP squad candidates. And we know that we can do this. We have very viable candidates like Alex Lee, who's running in a very competitive race again as an incumbent. So we hope that you come out and contribute to him, volunteer, door knock, and phone bank. We are less than 40 days away from election day and roughly 8 days till ballots drop. So the time is now, and none of us want to wake up on June 8th wishing that we'd given one additional hour to one of these amazing candidates who are really going to fight for working class, everyday Californians. So Alex, to share your website really quickly so folks know how to engage with you and your Instagram handle.
Absolutely. People can find more about me at votealexlee.com. And you can find me on social media at Alex_Lee. I'm on Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, all the great apps.